Welcome to this session, Humanity's Big Challenge, Water Wars, produced in partnership with Thames Water, who we're very thankful to. My name is Rossa Minogue. I work for the Institute of Ideas, and water issues have been in the news a lot of late, from the water crisis in Flint, Michigan, drought in California, protests and even riots over water privatization in Ireland, while here in Britain, the Environment Agency has declared the southeast of England to be under serious water stress. Internationally, there are even concerns that supply may be a cause of actual war and conflict in the 21st century. So this, you may have seen in the news in the last few weeks, Prime Minister Modi in India was threatening to cut off Pakistan's access to the Indus Valley waters, which supplies 3/4 of the people in Pakistan with water. We also want to ask, are these fears about resource wars over water being overblown, and the problems that do exist both in the UK and internationally, how do we solve them and what's the best way forward? Fiona Harvey, to my immediate right, will be speaking first. Fiona is an award-winning environment correspondent for The Guardian. She has reported on environmental issues from the Amazon to the Arctic and has interviewed people ranging from Tony Blair to Al Gore and Ban Ki-moon. On my far right is Dr. Sarah McCath. She is the Programme Director for Competition 2017 at Thames Water. Sarah has a background in science with a doctorate in environmental engineering. And outside of Thames Water, Sarah is a trustee of the Don McCath Foundation, a charity which provides free schooling for children in Gambia. Finally, we will have Dr. Caspar Hewett here on my left. Caspar is a lecturer in civil engineering at Newcastle University and is an honorary fellow of the Department of Geography at Durham University.
Lovely. Thank you very much for that splendid introduction, and thank you for asking me to come here today, because water is an issue that is very dear to my heart. I've been an environment correspondent for about 12 years now, and I think that water is the single most overlooked area of the environment that we could think of. If I write a story about, you know, gorilla going loose in London Zoo, or a story about polar bears dying in the Arctic, or a story about trees being chopped down in the Amazon, then it will get huge public interest. If I write a story about climate change, it gets huge public interest. If I write a story about water, if I ever even get to write a story about water, it generates much less interest, because people just don't realize what a massive issue this is. And in a sense, why should they? Because, you know, here it is, it falls out of the sky. You know, there couldn't be a more renewable resource, you would think. It's all around us, it's everywhere. So when people talk about water, they don't really connect between the water that is so constantly available, that falls down on us, and the water that is more abstract, as in shortages in various places. But let's think about where we get our water from. In the UK, I think we're about to hear that we have water shortages. This will seem incredible to you. One of the reasons we have water shortages is that many of the companies that provide our water actually sold off a great deal of their land that could have been used as reservoirs. Some of the actual reservoirs were sold off. In other cases, it was land that could have been used for reservoirs that was sold off. So that may be a question that comes up in a while. That's in the UK. When we look around the world, what's happening is that water is not being used in a rational way. So, for instance, We have places around the world where water is literally being mined. It is being taken up from aquifers far beneath the surface, that where the water has gathered there, it has taken thousands, if not tens of thousands, of years to gather in these aquifers, and yet we are pumping it out at an unsustainable rate. It's what we call fossil water. It's taken from such a depth at such an unsustainable way that it's simply not possible to carry on like that for very much longer. Some of the other absurdities of water. We have countries that are water stressed that are exporting huge amounts of water in the form of agricultural products, in the form of fabrics, in the form of manufactured goods. They are exporting these goods, which require a huge amount of water to make, and yet they are being sent overseas as if the water cost nothing. So, for instance, here's a glass of water. This glass holds, maybe 100, bit more, milliliters. How would you fit 3 liters of water into this glass? Really easy. You fill it with coffee. Because coffee requires so much water to grow. It requires 3 times, 4 times, 5 times even, as much water to grow a cup of coffee as it does to actually produce it, produce the final content. Similarly, anyone here wearing a pair of jeans? Right, there we go. That's about 500 liters of water has gone into that. Anyone drive a car? That's thousands of liters of water. So what we're doing is we're actually taking water from places in the world that are very water stressed, like Egypt, like Middle Eastern countries, like sub-Saharan Africa. We are taking water from those areas in the form of goods. That is water. Make no mistake about it. That is water coming from a very water-stressed area. And yet, no price is put upon that, because whatever price you are paying for these goods is not reflecting the water that is being taken away. It's not reflecting the fact that these areas are very short on water, and that that water is not being replaced and is, in fact, not replaceable. So, this is what we're up against. There is no equity across the world when it comes to water. Water is not factored in economically. We don't really have a free market in water. What we have is an absurd, a very inequitable, a very unfair, and a very stupid system of commerce around the world that is making all of us much poorer in terms of water and in terms of social justice.
Thank you. But I'd start by saying I agree with the first point that Fiona made, that water is probably the single most overlooked environmental impact that we have today. And for the same reasons, it's basically something that people regard as a basic right. It's essential for public health, it's essential for us as a society, but pretty much it just falls out the sky. So why do we worry about it? I was really pleased this morning to wake up to bright sunshine, because it helped me make my first point, which is contrary to whatever people might say, feel who live in our capital city, it actually doesn't rain very much in London. So we have less rainfall on an annual basis than places like Sydney, Barcelona, Istanbul. Whilst we get a lot of drizzle, we have a lot of clouds, a lot of grey days in London, what we don't get much of is sustained rainfall. So I'm just going to spend the next few minutes talking about specifically the Thames Water area and some of the issues in the UK. I'm less familiar with the worldwide issues, but happy to talk about those later. So our biggest challenge in London is really in this room, it's people. So we are a very densely populated part of the world, and the Thames Basin is actually one of the most intensively used water resource areas in the world. And whilst in worldwide, about 70 to 80%, depending on the area, of water is used in agriculture and manufacturing, in the London area, in the Thames Basin, we use about 50% of the available water for abstraction straight into drinking water. And we rely very heavily on our rivers. So for us, predominantly the River Thames. There isn't a huge amount of groundwater in this region. We don't have big aquifers that we extract from. But that means that we are highly reliant on the weather. So we're highly reliant on the rainfall and the recharging, making sure those rivers are kept topped up. And it might feel now like, well, what's the issue then? Over the last few years, really since 2012, our biggest challenge has been too much water. So we've had a couple of fairly significant flooding events, both in our area but across the UK. And flooding has been probably more of a concern than drought. And people quickly forget about drought and how close we come to running out of water. So if I just take you back 4 years to a time when the eyes of the world were on London, we were preparing for the 2012 Olympics, we came very close to having to impose some serious water restrictions. So what those restrictions would have meant is that people didn't have water 24 hours a day. So what we would have had to have gone to is a position where effectively, actually in common with lots of parts of the world, you couldn't guarantee that you could turn your tap on and water would come out whatever time of the day it was. The impact of that would have been huge, both on a personal level, but also on an economic level. So buildings like this would have to close because basically you couldn't flush the loos, so it wouldn't be a safe place to work or visit. Cooling units would fail, so you can't use the IT infrastructure because it's not safe. In extreme, the tube would have to shut down because it relies on a fire system which is reliant on water. And an independent survey showed that the economic impact just for this area, for the Thames Water region, could be up to £330 million a day impact on the economy. So what are we doing about it? So as we stand today with the current resources that we have and the current infrastructure, we could probably muddle through a drought year. We could put in every single bit of our plans that we have, all the backup, and we would probably manage over a single year. The challenge is a long succession of dry winters. And winter rain is really important because that's when it can percolate down into the soil and recharge the aquifers. But in the future, as the climate continues to change, we are going to have to look at different options. On top of that, the weather's changing. We also have a rapidly growing population. And again, for us in London, that is twofold. It's more people want to live here. More people are living in properties where historically there'd be one family. We've now got multiple families living in the same property, as well as the additional building of housing. But the additional challenge for London is, I don't know how many of you live outside of our region, I do. I've travelled into London today and will be using water as a visitor to London. So the number of people who are coming into this city, both for work purposes and for pleasure, is also a challenge on the amount of water we need to provide. So what are our plans, and similar to other parts of the UK? The first step has to be demand management. So making sure that, one, the amount of water that we put into our network, we keep as much of it in our network and get it to customers' taps, so that's reducing leakage, and working with our customers and our consumers to use less water. We have met our leakage targets for the last 10 years, but we still leak too much water, and there's still more to do there. But while fixing leaks is important, and it's a very emotive subject, the idea that over 20% of the water that we put into our system leaks out into the soil is not something that anybody feels comfortable about. But some of those pipes have been in London for over 100 years, and they're running down the centre of very busy streets. So the consequence of fixing leaks is that you have to look at the impact that has on the economy in terms of shutting roads down and digging up roads. So we are looking at smart technology where you can do that on a less invasive way, and that's sometime in the future. So on the demand management side, getting people to use less, and also to understand where our leaks are, a big part of that is smart metering. So again, I expect a number of you have got smart meters in your houses for energy usage. Mine's really annoying because it means my husband knows when all the appliances are on at home and it all goes red. But we're looking at that for water. And that helps us in two ways. It helps us understand the parts of our network where there's more water being used than we would expect. And that might be because it's leaking, or it might be because actually there's more people in that area, as I mentioned before, than we'd suspected. But it can also help us identify where there's a leak inside customers' houses. So if they know they weren't there during the day and nothing was left on, if there's water being used, there's a leak somewhere. And every time we install a smart meter, we go along and do a home visit to talk about how people might be able to save water within their house. But that can only go so far. So whilst we can focus on leaks and smart metering, we do need to build some new infrastructure in the future, as Fiona mentioned. We do have a new desalination plant in East London, and again, looking worldwide, desalination is used extensively in some parts of the world. Dubai and the UAE rely almost entirely on desalinated water, as do other more arid areas. But it's really, really, really expensive. It's really energy intensive, and the amount of energy you have to use just to generate a single megalitre of water is not something that is cost effective on a daily basis. So it's there, but it's there for a drought period. We are currently in the process of getting agreement on something called our Water Resources Management Plan, which is how we will deal with water resources over the next 25 years. And part of that is the need for a new storage reservoir. These are huge. In order to be effective, a storage reservoir needs to cover a significant amount of land, and these aren't things we can build inside central London. So in order to keep water flowing into London, we will need at some point to build a large storage reservoir. And hopefully we'll be able to work with other companies to ensure that that storage reservoir doesn't just help solve London's problems, but can also provide water to other parts of the southeast, which, as mentioned in the introduction, is formally declared a water scarce area. We're putting our plans together on that proposal at the moment. So any thoughts anyone has on what we need to include on that, I'd be really interested in. And we'll also be going out to public consultation in May 2017 and then January 2018. So I think I'll finish there, hand over to Caspar.
I'm going to come back to the title of this session, because when I saw the title, Humanity's Big Challenge, Water Wars, it did rather raise my eyebrows. Now, if you do a quick search, you might well think that water wars are brewing the world over. Here are just a few of the titles I came across this week when I did an internet search. Water wars, a new reality for business and governments. What you need to know about the world's water wars. Water wars, the next great driver of global conflict. And forget Star Wars, get ready for water wars. Okay, these are just some of the titles I came across. I'm going to, because I've got a bit of extra time, I'm actually going to quote from one of these. These aren't my words. A great war looms, one that will rise from the most desperate circumstance, our battle over water. It's all very dramatic. If trends persist and a growing body of scientific evidence holds true, we may be at war. Suddenly it starts getting very circumspect, but, or at least find ourselves hurled into new geopolitical conflicts for something that most of us, at least in the first world countries, take for granted, water. And it goes on and on, but the water wars of today may not be pervasive and prevalent, but someday soon they could be coming to a city near you, a situation that could lead to another kind of conflict, the slow death of progress and economic growth. And it goes along similar lines. Interestingly, towards the end of the article, and I just picked this out because it seems in contrast to what it just said at the beginning, we see the potential for this future today, from historic droughts to sucking dry aquifers, strained and nearly depleted by our unrestrained march of progress. So it's using progress in two very different ways there, which I thought was quite interesting, and no doubt we can talk about a bit about that in the discussion. But this, I mean, like the other articles that I've read, they've all got something in common. They're highly speculative and based on zero evidence. The reality is the water wars are a myth. They're almost non-existent throughout history. If you actually look at the evidence, it's just not there. Research shows that transboundary disputes over water tend to get resolved through peaceful means, one way or another. Even if the odd threat sometimes does get thrown around, and you do find that across history, you don't actually tend to find actual wars. And in fact, it's a lot more positive than that. Cooperation's the norm, as it is with so much of human behavior. So there's a really positive message here. I came across quite an amusing essay in Nature from 2009. It's Wendy Barnaby, if anyone wants to look it up, about how she was approached to write a book about water wars. And when she started to do the research, she came to the conclusion, and this is her words, that cooperation is the dominant response to shared water resources. Now, in the end, that book didn't get written because the publisher thought that that message wouldn't sell. It wasn't nearly as interesting as the other one, which they were hoping she, at the conclusion they were hoping she would come to. And I think that's quite interesting in itself. But despite this, we repeatedly hear proclamations about the water wars coming in the wake of climate change from the likes of the UN, the World Bank, and of course the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. Well, we should have none of it. Like so many catastrophe theories, we should dismiss them and debunk them with the real evidence. If anything, we should celebrate the fact that disputes like this do get resolved without resort to violence the world over. Now, that said, there are real issues related to people's access to potable water, which we've already talked about a little bit, and those should be taken seriously. After all, water is the most important resource of all, as it's essential to all life, not just human life, but all life. But my argument here is simple, and I have actually made this argument many times before, that there is absolutely no excuse for people anywhere in the world to suffer from lack of water. Drought is a social problem, although it's often discussed as if it's a natural one. Lack of water is about a lack of development or a lack of infrastructure or both. And this is critical in both the developing world and the developed world. Now let's get specific. Let's think about where we are. Here we are sitting in one of the most developed countries in the world, an island with high rainfall. And yet, serious drought in its most prosperous, populous region is being discussed as a reality, as we've just heard. It's beyond ludicrous. Yet it's a reality because of huge resistance to problem solving that's sadly typical today. There's a critique of desalination, for one thing, even though it's become increasingly efficient and high-tech. Yes, there are expenses, but it's improving all the time. Why? Why is there this critique? There's the question of our dilapidated infrastructure. Again, we've already referred to this. We're still reliant on a pipe network installed in the Victorian era in a lot of places. So we're seriously in need of investment in infrastructure. And there's also the critique of reservoirs, especially large ones. Now, again, talking about the reservoir that's needed for this region. And there's the Abingdon proposal, which has been going on, actually first proposed in 1975, which I think is quite interesting in itself. Now, I'm not going to go into the details of that one, because I actually spoke about that at some length 3 years ago here. Interestingly, absolutely nothing's happened. So if you want to know about that, just see what I said 3 years ago. It's rather shocking and depressing, but that's where we are. My own research on catchment systems engineering is highly pertinent here. Now, catchment systems engineering is all about joined-up thinking. It's about being proactive in solving problems and about a multi-pronged approach. We need to intervene across the whole urban and rural landscape, managing flow, storing water at key locations, and making sure water gets where we want it, when we want it. We can use big reservoirs to help control flow across the landscape. We can use small-scale interventions. We need a mix of these things. We can reduce flood risk, we can reduce pollution of our waterways, and we can introduce these interventions in a managed and rational way. We can engineer our way out of water shortages. We are a water-rich country. We can solve problems. The only barriers to doing so is a lack of will and a lack of imagination. Now, just a little aside, because again, I was looking at the blurb and it was saying, you know, what innovations would help the oncoming crisis. So before I wrap up, I thought I'd give you just one nice example of some innovative thinking. There's lots out there. Don't know if you've come across the Nemo's Garden Project. It's actually been on the news recently. It was, if you haven't, then look it up because it's quite nice. It's a research project looking at the potential for growing crops in the sea. And the crops are grown, you have these hydroponic pods that are below the water surface, and the location ensures a stable temperature. Sunlight's readily available, it just comes through the water. And the crops don't even require soil, they produce their own fresh water. It basically is a desalination plant, but it's just through evaporation of the seawater in the pod and you've got fresh water. Now, this is only being done on a small scale at the moment with a few crops like basil and lettuce and strawberries, but there's no reason why it shouldn't be scaled up and used for a wider range of crops. Could this be the agriculture of the future? No, maybe not. But the thing is, there's potential there. The implications could be really huge. But it's just one example. And like any other innovation, what it shows is that we should never assume too much about what the future will look like. What's a valuable resource 1 year is not needed the next. And what's a worthless substance 1 decade is an essential resource the next. Now, water may always be essential, but how we access it and use it could easily be unrecognisable in a few years' time. So, coming back to the blurb again, one of the key questions of the blurb was, has a lack of investment and political will created a false problem? Well, I'd just say a straightforward yes to that one. But the real question is what we do about that. The other half of that same question in the blurb is, will counter-crisis measures such as rationing become the norm? And this is the one that we really should be concerned about, because unfortunately, unless we fight it, rationing will become the norm when it really shouldn't. It's a political, not a technical question, and we need to respond accordingly. So let's start thinking more positively and invest in the future. Let's argue for development that will bring much needed infrastructure to people in parts of the world that need it. Let's get our own house in order, investing in the infrastructure we need to satisfy all our needs for the next century. And let's believe in ourselves and in the importance of people. Where we do identify problems, let's be proactive and set about solving them. If we do that, then any concerns we do have about water will come out in the wash.
Plenty to think about there from our three speakers, but now I want to hear what you have to say, your comments, questions, anything else you might want to say.
Hi there. First of all, it's great that this is a topic that's being discussed, because I think it's one of the most important challenges in terms of environmental movement and climate change. It hasn't got the same focus that the issue around burning fossil fuels has. I noticed there hasn't been a lot of discussion in terms of where the key water wars are likely to take place, despite what the gentleman was saying about there hasn't previously been a water war, which partly is because the population of the planet was in the millions up till recently. We now are facing 10 billion people all chasing the same resources. So I wonder if the panel can kind of discuss where the current key areas of tension are likely to be. The three that come off the top of my head are India and Pakistan. India, as most people know, control that a lot of the water goes into Pakistan with an agreement that was signed 1960s, 70s. And which has worked so far, and clearly there hasn't been a nuclear war, but that's an area clearly where tensions could arise. Obvious existing national and religious tensions could explode deleteriously, particularly with the overpopulation relative to natural resources of both countries. The second one that comes to mind, also a place where I haven't seen a lot of cooperation and love between people, is Israel and Palestine, underwater aquifers. The issue around Gaza, Palestine, Israel, and water depletion in the Negev Desert. So another place where it seems very unlikely people will sort of start hugging each other and being friends over such a precious resource. Even Syria, there's been discussion around how the droughts in 2009 contributed to the current conflicts going on there and the internal refugees brought about by climate change. And another one, I suppose, that comes to mind is in the Andes Mountain and Peru and the Mesoamerican societies there that are dependent on the glaciers there in the Andes for their water. If those start to dry up, you know, tens of millions, hundreds of millions of people could die. So I just wonder if you have maybe the panel discuss any one of those, because it seems like there's, you know, hitting a point potentially, it could be a huge flashpoint. And as we all know, water, people die within 3-4 days of not having it. Hence it's important, but thanks very much.
I really appreciate the positive attitude on the panel of being proactive and trying to solve the problems and even bringing it back to the home first. I just was recently in Bermuda and was so surprised to find that they have been catching the rainwater on residents' houses' roofs for the last 80 years and using that as drinking water on the island. And I was curious because it seems like such a low-tech, easy solution to catching as much rainwater as possible without having to worry about the infrastructure problems that persist around the city, but just, you know, painting your roof in a certain manner and catching that water. So I'd just like to throw that idea back.
I'd just like to, I think, take issue with a couple of points that Dr. McGrath made. The statement that we had short memories and that we can't remember when there was a drought, I think we do remember when there was a drought. I remember the water restrictions. And when we had the water restrictions, we remembered very well indeed that a couple of years earlier we'd had the floods. And that's what we were talking about. Why have we got these water restrictions when last year we had more water than we needed? Secondly, I've got a question about the priority for Thames Water, which is to reduce its customers' demand rather than to meet the demand by building reservoirs. If it was a proper commercial business, its number one priority would be to meet customer demand by building reservoirs.
I'm just curious as to why we don't move more water around. You know, we just heard about the situation with the Thames catchment, and so I think Britain faces what a lot of countries face, which is we've got most population in the southeast, and it rains most in the northwest. It just seems logical that we should be able to move some water from one side of the country, you know, from the west coast to the east coast. I know China has recently, I haven't looked at how they're doing this, but I understand they've built a new piping system, they're piping water like 900 miles or something. You know, surely the question was raised about which parts of the world are their problems. I mean, in all parts of the world, the continents, there are areas where there's, too much rain and areas where there's not enough rain. So, yeah, I mean, we pipe oil over thousands of miles. We pipe gas. I'm just curious as to if there's any insight on the panel as to why we're not doing more moving water around land.
So you said there had not been wars in the past over water. I think you forget about China. China was set up as a result of wars over the two rivers, the Yangtze and the Yellow, which are fundamental to China when it was a set of warring states, and then it put it all together. So there is a historical record for wars over water. And actually, I wanted to raise the cultural point about water, because our attitude to water seems to vary in different parts of the world. I've had some dealings with water in the United States, and where there's a feeling, I think, you should be able to take water from under your feet. It should be fresh, drinkable, and inexhaustible, all of which are, you can't deal with. I had particularly to deal with a problem in Santa Monica in California, where a well had become contaminated, and there was an argument about where it was coming from. There were 40 different potential contamination sites of significant size within 1 mile of that site. I mean, some people have completely unrealistic attitudes to water supply. It needs to be properly managed, and I think it's well, a point needs to be made. It is a human-managed resource. It's not just a natural resource. We've moved a long way since then, but some people believe it's entirely natural and it should be, and then we're living on top of it. You can't operate like that. And the Americans, I believe, don't even consider recycling water as an acceptable practice. So they would be aghast at what happens in London. But, you know, water, we use water as a functional fluid. You can recycle it umpteen times. It may be essential. It goes through. You can clean it up and reuse it. I mean, there's a technological solution, but there are cultural resistances in actually, in even Western areas, that do limit what you can do. So it isn't just a technological problem.
Thank you. I first want to say that there was an issue around opinion and academic research. So I'm all in favour, and free speech is fine. But I think some of the things we said were opinion and unreferenced people from the internet articles. I don't think it's a very academic way to commence a particular discussion. So that's as an academic critique. And I'm sure there's other ones you could. I also had a minor critique of the fact that it's Thames Water, which is a private corporation regulated in part by government, which is sponsoring this seminar. It's quite an interesting concept in itself, given what we're talking about, when we're looking at going beyond boundaries. That's one of the problems, is we cantonize things up. Talking quickly about the issue around, we talk about air pollution moving across borders and these international things. So you've got these boundaries, and the air pollution sometimes crosses over. So that's been good for some people to try and internationalize the issues. And this can occur with water as well, but not in all places. And in fact, the gentleman a bit further up the front referred to Gaza, for instance, in Palestine. Now, that's an area where there's 2 million people living, half of whom are under 16 years of age. And they don't have any clean water at all, if less than 5% of their water's clean. And the big issue there is that the effects of the raw sewage going into the Mediterranean Sea would be felt by our neighbours across the Mediterranean, but for the fact the Mediterranean doesn't swirl the liquid of the Mediterranean around sufficiently. So therefore, you have such a million children, 2 million people in Gaza living with no access to clean water at all. But the international community ignores that because it's not directly affected, although, of course, refugees flows. There we go. So thank you very much.
Thank you for some brilliant comments from the floor and some excellent questions. Just to take the first one I think we had was about sort of water wars and tension. And Caspar addressed this issue as well, and I think the issue here is that no one ever says they're going to war over water, but then no one ever said they were going to war over oil in Iraq, but were they? Come on, you know. So there is, water is kind of a hidden issue when it comes to conflicts. It's there, but it's not declared as a reason for war, as a reason for conflict. But then, you know, the real reasons for conflict are very rarely declared. And we had a list from one of the speakers here of some of the conflicts that in which water probably played a part: Israel, Palestine, Syria. We had China over here and so on. And to that I would add Sudan, Eritrea, Ethiopia, you know, places where we've had huge problems, sometimes open conflict, sometimes just a state failing, sometimes just, you know, a mass migration of people. Because basically what happens when people don't have water or don't have access to water is that it's quite simple. It's exactly what any one of us would do. We leave. You know, if there's no water there, if you can't carry on life without water, you leave. You move to somewhere else. You have this kind of migration of people, and I think that water and water issues are behind much more of the migration of people than we are currently willing to acknowledge. So that's there. We also had this issue about that moving water around. The problem with moving water around, I think it was a gentleman down here who asked this, have you ever paid for a bottle of mineral water? Costs a fortune, you know. It costs you about £1 for about, you know, twice as much as this. It's very expensive to move water around. Water is big. And you need a lot of it. All of us need a lot of it every day. And you can't really move it in any other. You can't evaporate it and then reconstitute it like noodles. You know, you need it to be still water. And it takes up a lot of space and it's expensive to move, so that's the problem. There was an idea a few years ago when we had a drought a few years ago. There was a lot of talk about bringing an iceberg, floating it down the Thames, and then melting it so we could all have melted ice. This would be, I don't know how much it could cost you, you will probably be able to tell us, but this is just infeasible. Water really is the most local of resources. It's very easy to export it in the form of, as I said, you know, agriculture or manufactured goods. It's very, very difficult to create it at its source, which is where you need it. We had also this issue of water restrictions and reservoirs. Well, we do need more reservoirs at the moment in London, on the east of the city, as I understand it.
Yeah.
And most of the water supply, the reservoirs and so on, are in the west.
Yeah.
So we have a kind of logistical problem. So basically water is not just a social issue. I think, Caspar, I think you said that the drought is a social issue. Actually, it's a geographical issue as well. I mean, you can't really separate water from geography. And we have countries around the world where they're used to dealing with water shortages, and traditional way of lives would incorporate that knowledge of how to deal with water shortages. And now, in those very same areas, we've got things like golf courses, you know, which soak up huge amounts of water, you know, or five-star hotels with swimming pools and things like that. So we are using water in a completely unsustainable way, given our geography. So I agree, it's a social issue, but it's also a geographical issue. Yeah, no, I know. I'm confirming what you say. I think we have to acknowledge the geography. Yeah. Thanks.
Thank you, Sarah.
Thank you. I'll pick up some of the points. I mean, there were a couple of points specifically asked around from water company perspective. But if I could just start with the first question about water wars and where they might take place. I think one of the... I'll come on to sort of the theme I want to pick up about options. And one of the interesting countries you mentioned was Israel. And if you look at what's happened in Israel over the past, for the past 40, 50 years, is that their necessity has very much driven innovation. So they are world leading in desalination technology, both on a macro scale and both on scaling that down. So I think there are some really important lessons for us to learn as a developed country, and sometimes thinking, well, we get technology, this is what we do, from some of those countries where actually they've been driven to develop innovative techniques. And somebody else mentioned wastewater recycling. Again, there are parts of the world who are far further ahead than the UK in wastewater reuse. America is not one of them. But if you look at those countries, what they tend to have is a completely different cultural view of water. And the biggest issue for us in the UK, and in a lot of the developed world, definitely in America, around wastewater recycling, is the view that that's a bit disgusting. You're really saying you're going to take my poo and wee and turn it back into water? No way. The reality is that happens every day in London and in every other city in this country, because we take water out of a river, we clean it up, we use it as sewage, we clean up that sewage, and we put it back into the same water course. And one of the challenges is actually getting people's head around that's just normal and the water that you have is safe to drink. So to pick up on a couple of the points over sort of specific questions around things like reducing demand, over building reservoirs, over moving water around, the really important thing to look at in terms of long-term water sustainability is that there isn't a single answer. There's not a single answer for us in London and the Thames Valley, and there's not a single answer for the UK. In reality, the answer to the scarcity in the southeast will be a combination of all the things we've talked about. And we are looking at moving water around, for example. We're looking at a transfer from the River Severn down into the southeast. That's one of the options in our water resources management plan. But as Fiona said, water is really heavy, and so you have the issues of the cost of that. But it is absolutely one of the feasible options. Rainwater capture, again, somebody mentioned. Again, it's viable, and it's something we need to look at more. We need to look at more of the, not just the water we use being reused, but more of the natural water, the rainfall, being captured and getting back into a usable resource. And I think somebody made an interesting point about water boundaries. One of the things that I feel really passionately about, not just because I work for Thames Water, but because having spent 22 years being passionate about water as the most essential thing to life, is that actually one of the challenges we have is that there are boundaries in the UK. There are boundaries between water companies. And one of the things we're looking at is how we work together across the South East to effectively look at solutions which transcend those boundaries. And that's hard because we're a regulated monopoly business and we work within a highly regulated structure. But we will not solve the problems of the next 30 years by only thinking Thames Water and not recognising that the problem for us is a problem in the South East.
I did not claim that there are never any tensions in the world over water. There are. What I did do is say that the evidence and the academic research around this says that these don't tend to explode into wars. You actually have these tensions and they tend to get resolved in various ways. Now, I don't think anybody, let's take Israel and Palestine. I don't think anybody here would claim that the tensions between Israel and Palestine are caused by the water conflict. We know it, that's not the case. You know, there are all sorts of historical things at play, lots of complex things at play between India and Pakistan. You know, the tensions between India and Pakistan have not been created by tensions over water. They've actually been in existence since the formation of India and Pakistan, and there's lots of complex politics behind it. So, you know, so don't misread what I'm saying. I'm not saying there aren't any tensions. What I'm saying is that these, you know, water is not directly causing a war in this place. You know, and that is what's being falsely presented by a lot of the media. You know, those examples I gave, none of those were academic papers, to come to your point. I'm sort of trying to bring them all together. You know, those titles I cited were all things that were, you know, internet articles and newspaper articles and so on. None of them were academic papers, and none of them cited any academic evidence or evidence of any sort. They were just making claims about these wars are coming, and that was my point. If you actually look at, say, the Interwater Management Institute's you know, recent report looking at water wars, they came to the conclusion that I was saying, you know, that they actually just generally don't happen.
Is water shortage causing migration of people?
It does in places, yeah.
Migration of people is a key source of conflict.
Okay, we can continue this conversation, but let me just come to some of the other things, and we can maybe, you know, maybe people want to broaden that out. But the, I mean, the capturing water on roofs, this sort of thing, I mean, there's nothing wrong with these technologies, but they're actually not sufficient for the sort of scale that we're talking about. If we're talking, say, about the southeast of England, or if we're talking about a developing country that has got, you know, massively under-resourced in then rainfall capture on roofs is not sufficient. Yeah, it's a good, simple technology, and there's no reason not to use it, but it's not going to solve the problems. Moving water around, there actually can be some issues with that, in that, I mean, there are some of the things that were alluded to about borders and so on, but also just about mixing water from different places, and then that they are open to solution, but it's complicated. It's not just as simple as we can just stick a pipe here and we can mix that water and that water. We've got to be a little bit careful, and you've actually got to really think this through and plan it properly, which is what I would propose doing. I would propose doing that big scale infrastructure, but you've really got to think about what you're mixing where and where it is or isn't going to cause a problem. So yes, you can, but it's not as simple as it might seem. I agree entirely about and I think you're probably just underlining my point about human-managed resource. You know, water is not a natural resource. I mean, water naturally occurs, but the fact that it's a resource is to do with the way we use it. You know, that resources are only resources if we're using something. So, and it is entirely human-managed, and part of the thinking behind, so I've mentioned catchment systems engineering, is actually recognising that there's no catchment on the Earth that hasn't been altered by human activity. You know, that's part of our understanding, that's our start point, and say, okay, we've altered catchments, but we can continue to alter catchments, and now we can do that rationally, or we can do that stupidly and accidentally. You know, and actually, I would argue we should do that rationally and think about how we alter them and actually engineer those systems. And yeah, it isn't just a technological problem, but I think I said that in my introduction, it is a social one.
I just wanted to pick up on the point that you said that there was a lack of imagination. I'm a designer, and I think design now is moving into a very cross-disciplinary area, which works with experts to solve big problems like sustainability. So I actually think that you're actually very wrong in saying that there's a lack of imagination. There's a lot of people now working on very inventive solutions. The problem comes first with investment. Who are you going to get to invest in your projects and actually push them forward so that they can actually benefit a more wider range of people? And second, people, because, you know, you're talking about changing the habits of human beings, and how many people are actually willing to do that? I think that's also something that we have to keep in mind. So I don't think it's a lack of imagination. I think it's a lack of solving problems in the whole system.
I got interested in this issue when, probably 3-4 years ago, one of my clients, Syngenta, published a stat on its homepage of its website about, by the year 2050, 4 billion people will live in countries with water scarcity. Now, I don't know where that stat came from, and maybe that generated a lot of the sort of papers and things like that. But my question to the panel is, you know, clearly if that projection, when you look at the rate of climate change and the do we go above or below the 2 degrees increase in temperature globally, if you get that scale and someone has done the maths about that many people being impacted, then it would dwarf, the amount of migration it would cause would dwarf the Syrian issue. And look how much debate and problems that's generated. So question to the panel is, do you recognize that figure? Have you looked at any studies around or any information around that sort of 2050 timescale? And what do you think the consequences might be if that happened?
Hello, you've been talking about it's difficult to move water around, but I'm not disagreeing with that. But there is a case study of the LA River where they've engineered a whole system to move water so quickly out of the city, it stops flooding. So how can we do that and cope with the flooding issue, but we can't move water around to actually give water to people that need it?
Hi, Fraser Myers, Worldwrite. I just wanted to comment on the way that there just seems to be a complete lack of politics in a lot of this discussion, you know, not the discussion here, but in the discussion in general, in the sense that, you know, all these kind of conflicts are being blamed on water and resources rather than the underlying politics in the region. Mm-hmm. And also our kind of vision for the future is completely devoid of politics as well, because it's based on these kind of catastrophizing ideas of, you know, oh, there's going to be all this enormous drought or whatever. It doesn't encompass a bold sort of vision for the future. You know, to kind of bring it back to the sort of utopia strand that this is a part of. I wondered if the panel could comment on that.
Yeah. I'd like to query, particularly with Fiona, why it is that she describes the use of water in the manufacture of export goods or agricultural products as exporting water. Because not a drop of that water is, in fact, exported. It ends up right where it came from. Now, the issue of how that water is recycled or treated or whatever is an issue for local water management. But it is a very misleading and an inflammatory thing to say that the water is exported in the jeans and the cars and the coffee beans, because it isn't. It stays where it is.
A completely opposite point to what he just made, which is that we need to return to the ethical dimension of this debate. So when you said that 500 litres are used to make a pair of jeans, most of us don't care because no pairs of jeans are made in our communities. No coffee beans are grown in our country. So yes, this water is exported, but a lot of the water we use actually isn't used in our communities. So we need to talk about the ethical dimensions of localizing water and making sure that local people actually have first priority and first access. 23 million people in Bangladesh lack access to clean water, yet Bangladesh remains one of the largest exporters of garments. So how is it that people who grow, who make these products that we consume, lack the basic access to clean drinking water? So yes, I'm sorry, they do export water to us through the 500 litres per garment of jeans that we wear, or the 5 litres per cup of coffee that we drink.
Sorry, a bit controversial perhaps, because I work for Thames Water, but if water was the same price as petrol, how much would you use? Because I think fundamentally the problem is that water is just too cheap. Discuss.
Management of water has been fundamental to the growth of civilizations around this planet. That's how civilizations started, by managing the water supply and bringing agriculture. So it's a sign of a civilization that can manage its water supply. I think you should bear that in mind. That said, I just want to throw out another one which isn't directly connected with this. We need to learn to manage the climate.
I'll be quick. Now, just a quick point. In terms of the conflict, I think the point that I was trying to get to wasn't that Israelis or Palestinians in Pakistan have problems caused by water. It's if there is a water shortage, say, for example, only 10 people in this room, we only had enough water for 10 people, and people got very desperate. It's easy to imagine groups forming where they would kill other people so that they could survive. And therefore, if people already hate each other, it's likely that with the intense water pressure, and Israel and Palestine both have massively exploding populations despite the innovations and technology the lady was mentioning, it's almost unbelievably obvious and uncontroversial statement to say those tensions are likely to get much worse if there's not enough water for everyone and they already don't get on in any peaceful situation whatsoever. So that was really the point I was going to emphasize, and also just that it's sometimes a shame that environmental issues are sort of siloed off from issues around Israel, Palestine, Sudan, wherever. For example, you know, you're very unlikely to go to a debate on Israel and Palestine with someone who's an expert on water, who can discuss the water issue. And I think that's sometimes why there is a problem, is that people have this tendency to sort of silo off environmental issues around climate change, say they shouldn't be involved in a discussion on Syria or Israel and just should kind of stick to their own little areas and sort of go on Greenpeace hippie marches, where in fact it's essential, because we all need water to live and we all need food to eat and we all share the same planet, and therefore we have to look after it.
I just wanted to respond to that, really, because I think if there was only enough water for 10 of us in the room, I would kind of hope that people here would say, right, well, what are we going to collectively do about it, rather than kind of fight over that those 10 bits of water? I mean, the whole thing about the water wars, which kind of, you know, surprises me, I mean, I live close to Carlisle, and a friend of mine was flooded out 10 months ago. You know, I mean, I guess he would be saying, well, you know, if it's a war over water, I kind of surrender, because we've had to kind of leave our house and whatever. And I think, you know, the issue is that our society should be able to solve problems like flooding, solve problems like the water shortages that happen in other parts, in certain parts of the country, do that collectively rather than kind of fight over you know, 10 glasses of water, you know, or whatever.
Okay, thank you very much. We'll come back to the panel now. You each have 3 minutes to respond to anything that's come from the floor or what other panelists have said, and you can also wrap up as well, make a closing statement.
Thank you for that. I thought we've had a brilliant discussion and some fantastic contributions, and I just want to address a few of them. We had a brilliant contribution here about, you know, really, you know, we should be caring about conflicts and so on. I'm an environmental journalist. I've been an environmental journalist for over a decade. I can't remember how long. And basically, the reason I'm an environmental journalist is not because I only care about polar bears. It's because I actually care about people. And environmental problems are social problems. And environmental problems cause social issues. They cause conflicts. They cause difficulties in people's lives. It's, you know, you cannot care about people unless you care about the environment in which we live. And that, to me, is essential. So I think you made a really important point there. And the fact that some people would like to hive off environmental issues and treat them as if they're something that you only care about if you're middle class, well, you know, bugger off, really, because that's just nonsense. You need to care about these things. We had another excellent point made by the gentleman behind you about the management of water resources. And you, because I made the point about exporting goods is effectively exporting water. To get into the economics of this, this is about economic internalities and externalities. And water is an externality. It's treated as if it's free. And that's the problem. So basically, the real cost of water, the social cost of water, and the economic cost of water are not factored in to the pricing of export goods. And that means that people are effectively, as I said before, they're mining water from deep underground, from deep aquifers, which will take thousands and thousands of years to replenish. They're taking water from rivers where it is not being replenished in that river system. The river system is being polluted. So the real, actual, social, and indeed economic cost of water is not being factored in. It is not being borne. We had another excellent point over here. I think you were talking, Sarah, about Bangladesh. You raised a really important issue because the elephant in this room, the thing that we have not addressed at all, really, in this entire discussion, is the issue of sanitation. Because you cannot really talk about water supply without talking about how we are pooing in our own water supply, basically. In so many places around the world, you cannot find clean water, you know, because you do not have adequate sanitation. Now, we've got loos here. Everyone in this place has a loo in their home. You know, why can't we have that in other places in the world? There really is no reason, except that we are not building that infrastructure. We are not looking on sanitation as a social issue. And sanitation is also a gender issue, of course, because it prevents women, young girls, really, from going to school. And I think I've said everything that I wanted to, really. Thank you.
Sarah.
Okay. So I would sort of sum up by saying I agree with all the points made about this being an ethical, a social and a political issue. I don't think the politics are talked about enough, and I think politics has a large part to play in water, actually in this country as well as across the world. But if I can sort of sum up, well, what does that mean for us now and in the future? I think that recognition that water is essential to life and is not a free natural resource that drops out the sky is absolutely something we need to talk about and something that people should be conscious of. I also think that there is a great opportunity for people to understand more about the water cycle, about the impact that sanitation has on clean water supplies. And actually a great opportunity, somebody talked about design, a great opportunity for innovation. So you can see across the world where people have been in the sort of scarcity situations that we're facing now in this country, how that innovation has come forward. And I think there's a great opportunity for us to look at a wide balance of options, moving water around, recycling wastewater, reducing demand, or understanding demand and making a conscious choice to reduce your demand. And then on top of that, new infrastructure and the impact that that has on our economy as well. I'll finish there.
Thank you.
Who was it who asked about the if scenarios? I think the 2050 question. It is something that's quite interesting, and a lot of people in the department I work in Newcastle do a lot of research around. So I have looked at these sorts of things. But the trouble with those if scenarios is the assumptions that are made in those models. And I don't just mean the mathematical models of what might happen to the climate, but actually the assumption always is, and pretty much has to be when you're doing that sort of analysis, that 2050 will look like today. Now, I really hope 2050 looks nothing like today. I think, you know, that's 35 years ago. And I think back, I'm actually old enough now to easily think back 35 years, sadly. Everything, it looks unrecognizable. I mean, you know, there are so many things we didn't even have. What we would call a resource was different. You know, I mean, you actually think silicon wasn't a resource, you know, pretty much at that time. But, I mean, it's really hard to imagine how we'll be living, what will be the most important resources, what society will look like in 2050. So to then try and project, the climate scenarios onto that, it is very hard because we may have technologies we don't know about. We will have technologies we don't know about. You know, there's all these things. So you take it with a pinch of salt. I'd rather take the utopian approach and sort of say, no, I'd like to have a vision where society will look like this and we'll have all these things we haven't thought about. We'll have these sources of energy, we'll have things, you know, we'll have fusion, we'll have, you know, electric cars driven by fusion power, so we will, you know, all these things, in which case it's going to look nothing like that, and those projections are, you know, that's the way I would approach that. So that answers two questions, I hope. On your question, yeah, we can move water around. I mean, that was really what I was trying to get at. The fact that it's difficult doesn't mean we shouldn't do it. We should do it. I'm a great believer in that, and I actually think that it takes will, and we've got to win the arguments, and that's why actually discussions like this are important, because we do need to win the arguments, and then we've got to go out from here and continue to win the arguments for change and for bold visions and for saying, no, we actually want to get the water from A to B where we want it, when we want it, as much as we want. Forget demand management. Let's actually supply where we think we need supply. And let's manage the climate as well. Yeah, I'm with you on that one too, I think. But it's a very unpopular view. So, you know, those of us who think that, let's go out there and win those arguments.
Thank you very much. I'd like to thank Thames Water, and I think we've had a very interesting discussion today, so can we thank our panellists, please?